we want to hope and pray that God will bless you, that He'll bless you real good. We ask that if you're traveling back home, that God will allow you Godspeed back to your home and places of abode.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
We want to keep prayer for Brother Wesley R. Brown, who was in a bad car accident. We want to keep him in prayer. From my understanding, he broke a bone in his hip and his neck, and so we're going to keep him in prayer. He's in a medical current, but we don't know his immediate status. Just hope and pray that you just keep him uplifted. We know Brother Brown is in the traveling ministry. He's an elder. He is a minister in narratives at the Western Church of Christ, and he's also currently working at Morgan Avenue Church of Christ. And so he does so many things for so many people.
Amen.
It's just sad that God's faithful servant is injured. So we want to keep him in prayer.
Amen. Amen.
If you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask that you turn to the book of Psalm 100. It's the chapter. We're going to extrapolate a thought this morning. And I hope to be short and powerful. Amen.
Right.
You say amen, and I'll be short and powerful. Amen. If you don't say amen, I'll just be powerful. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Psalm 100. It's a very familiar text to most of us who've been in the church or never read your Bible. The Bible says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name, or speak well of his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endure to all generations.
That's right.
In a speech made in 1863, Abraham Lincoln said, we have been the recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. We have been preserved these many years in peace and prosperity. We have grown in numbers, wealth, and power as no other nation has ever grown before. But we have forgotten God. We have forgotten the gracious hand which preserved us in peace and multiplied and enriched and strengthened us. And we have vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts that all of these blessings were produced by some superior wisdom or virtue of our own. Intoxicated with the unbroken success, we have become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of the redeeming and preserving grace, too proud to pray to the God that made us. It was Judson Cornwall who said, whenever the method of worship becomes more important than the person of worship, we have already prostituted our worship. There are entire congregations whose worship and praise and worship, but who have yet to learn, praise, and worship God in Christ Jesus. Imagine that you are a Jew who lives in the ancient Near East. The time for one of the Jewish annual feasts has come. You make your pilgrimage from where you live to the holy city of Jerusalem. In obedience to the Torah or the Old Testament, and your ultimate destination is the temple. Your purpose is worship, and your motivation is thanksgiving. Brothers and sisters, you have left home focused, determined, and expectant. But something changes along the way. The journey is long and the sun is hot. The path is unyielding. The animal that you bring to sacrifice is burdensome. And the caravan that you're traveling with is noisy. You left home focused, but now you are frustrated. And you keep asking yourself the question, why did I leave home again to go through this? You can't answer that question because you have lost sight of the reason you are headed to Jerusalem in the first place. You would go home, but you have traveled this far. You might as well press on. So you press on until you begin to draw near to Jerusalem. Then you begin to hear noises of joyful and beautiful praise, harmonious noises. And you reach the gates of the city, and you see the source of this joyful noise. There are greetings and greeters there waiting for you. And they don't greet you with a handshake. Instead, they lift a song. As the words of the song sink in your mind, your frustration begins to melt away. And you regain focus for worship. This would be the experience of many pilgrims who would travel to Jerusalem for worship. They would make their way, losing sight of why they were going along that way until they would hear the great singers and lifting up a call to worship. The call to worship is what we must do. And the call to worship is what is talked about in Psalms 100. Psalms 100 is one of the most beloved psalms in all the Psaltery. It is only rivaled by popularity by Psalms chapter 23. It has been a regular part of Jewish worship since antiquity, and it has been central to Christian worship throughout history. In fact, the 16th century reformers, they paraphrased this psalm and set it to metric tunes, and they would sing this psalm. But of course, there are other psalms that focus on thanksgiving, but this is the only psalm in the entire book that is super subscription, a psalm of thanksgiving. Brothers and sisters, we're going to see three main points this morning. The first is the presence of worship. The presence of worship. Now, if you look at verse number one, the Bible says here, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. The first thing you see is that the Bible says we must make something. That word make means that we must shout, we must cry. It is a joyful noise unto the Lord. And I want you to notice also that it is not just God's people that are commanded to make a joyful noise. The Bible says, all ye lands. And the reason why God can command that is because he's made every person.
Amen.
And then he says, serve. That's the second commandment in that verse. Serve means to labor, to work. He says, serve the Lord with gladness. And then he says, come before his presence with singing. Sometimes we can serve the Lord, but it's less with gladness and more with madness.
Amen.
But when you know who has created you, and you know what he's done for you, you can then make a noise. You see, many of us came to church and we were waiting for the song leader to get us hyped, get us in the mood to worship, praise the Lord. And yes, song leaders can do that. But I want you to understand that before you step foot in this church building, you should have had a song in your heart. Last I read in Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 18, the Bible says, be ye not drunk with wine as an excess, but be ye filled with the Spirit. And so, brothers and sisters, that is the command. Oftentimes we go there to say, we got to sing, but really the command is not to sing, the command is to be filled with the Spirit. And then he gives us five participles. He says, singing in your heart, singing hymns, psalms, and spiritual psalms. And then he watches, he says, giving thanks. So before you come to church, there should be a song in your heart. Now, if you don't believe that, all you got to do is remember last night when you took a shower. You were Luke Evangelos. It didn't matter how you sounded because you sounded good. You knew in your heart the words that you belted out. You didn't get a contract for. Praise the Lord. And if it wasn't that, you were Aretha Franklin singing the national anthem. You added your little twist to it. Amen. Because in your heart, you are already singing the song. So the psalmist tells us here, he says, you must enter into God's presence, the presence of worship, by not only making a shout, but serving with gladness. And then he says, and enter before his presence with singing. Now that's important because in the ancient Near East custom, if you were to be called before a king, you were to come with the king, in front of the king, in his presence with a smile. You recall the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah was called by King Nebuchadnezzar. He came in, and the Bible says his countenance had fallen. King Nebuchadnezzar asked him, he said, what is wrong with you? And Nebuchadnezzar got nervous because to enter into the presence of a king and you look sad, that would be a bad situation. You could sometimes even lose your life. When you came before a king, you were to smile, you were to be happy. And so the text teaches us. He says, make a joyful noise. And then he says, serve the Lord with gladness. And then he says, come before his presence with singing.
All right.
So we have to enter into God's presence today. Not with glibness and not with looking sour and sad, but we ought to come to God knowing who God is. Praise the Lord. Brothers and sisters, that's why I have titled this sermon, Happy Thanksgiving. Happy Thanksgiving. It's not Happy Thanksgiving because that's just a one-day event. It's not like Black Friday. It's not like Cyber Monday. This should be a living thing. It should be something that you do every day of your life. You should have a happy Thanksgiving. Brothers and sisters, understand why we should be thankful to God every day. Verse 2 says, serve the Lord with gladness, come before his presence with singing. But not only that, you also have to understand something else, brothers and sisters. When you enter the presence of worship, you have to have the preparation of worship. Verse number 3 says, know, underline know. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that have made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Do you see that in the Bible?
Yes.
Watch this now. He says, no. Yada in the Hebrew, it means to recognize, and it means to know by experience.
Yes.
Hallelujah. God says, you've got to know some things before you can prepare to worship. He says, you have to know that the Lord, he is
God.
You know, it reminds me of the Hebrew Shema over there in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse number 4. But the Bible says there, he says that the Lord our God is one God. He is one Lord. It simply means Jehovah, our Elohim, is one. And so in this day of duplicity, in this day of syncretism, we have people that want to combine every other God with the real God. They want to say that Allah is God.
Right.
And if you don't agree that Allah is God, then you're Islamophobic, and you don't like other people that think differently from you. But I'm going to suggest to you that there is only one God. There's only one God, and the Bible says there's none beside him. I don't care what the politically correct thing to say or to do is. I know what the Bible teaches.
Amen.
Lord is one God.
Amen.
There's none beside him.
Right.
He and we are made. The Bible says we are made by Him. He has made us. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26. The Bible describes the time that He took man from the dirt of the earth and He put His spirit in him. It says, and God said, watch this, let us make man.
All right.
Yeah. Let us make man. Let us, asa, man in our own image.
Yeah.
And then He says, and let us make him after our likeness. Now, I want you to catch something here because He didn't say mine, He said our.
Yes.
Well, you just said He was one Lord. How is He now our? That's a plural pronoun. What do you mean, our? He says, no. The Lord our God is one God.
Yes.
But when God says, let us, He's talking about the triune personality of the Godhead. He's talking about God the Word, God the Spirit, God the Father. They all make up the one Lord. And in that one Lordship, they have control. They have creative power. The Bible says that they made man in His image or our image. So when we look at Psalms chapter 100 verse 3, and He says, you should know that the Lord, He is God, and it is He that hath made us. Understand why He makes that important. He said, it is God that created you.
Amen.
And if you know anything about creation, the Creator has power over the thing that's been created.
Amen.
So it should not seem strange to us that He commands us to give Him what He deserves.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Some of us have greater fame, but we get mad when folks don't give us praise. We make a cake and nobody says thank you. Nobody says this is really good. We get upset though. Because we took the ingredients, even though we didn't make the ingredients. We put the ingredients together, didn't we? We put our blood, sweat, and tears in that thing. And we expect somebody somewhere to say thank you. You know that just a couple of days ago. Whoever made the potato salad. Whoever made the stuffing or the dressing, we say down south. And nobody made a comment? Nobody said it was good? I mean, you had greens, beans, tomatoes, chicken, cauliflowers, turkey, ham. You didn't even thank you. You had it all, but nobody said thank you. Nobody cared about what you cooked. But you have a Creator that has done all of that. Brothers and sisters, all He says is, you know I made you. So when you come to me, give me praise. And as we hasten on, we understand the preparation of worship. He says here, He says, we must have the mindset to give God the praise. God is worthy of cheerful service.
Yeah.
Nobody enjoys a servant who is moping and depressed, who is not cheerful. Who takes your business as being irksome? Have you ever gone to a restaurant and somebody's treated you that way?
Amen.
They act like they didn't really want to wait on you in the first place. That's how the children of God can be sometimes. God has blessed us with so much and He asks for so little. But even when He asks us for things, it just seems like it gets on our nerve. Believers ought to do things out of a cold sense of dutiful obligation. That's how we think. But really, it should be out of a heart of overflowing gratitude and joy. God's people should sing joyfully to Him in worship.
Amen.
That's why I'm so glad this morning John sung with all the spirit he had. He moved us to sing. He entered into the presence of God with that singing. Let me tell you something. The Bible says God inhabits the praises of His people.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
You want to get into the presence of God?
Hallelujah.
You just better sing from the heart.
Amen.
And you can enter into God's presence.
Amen.
Lucifer, the morning star, he was the praise leader of the heavenly choir, if you will.
Right.
Lucifer was a beautiful angel, but Lucifer could sing. You know, it reminds me of how sometimes we lose track of just simple things like that. I believe it's over there in Isaiah, I believe it's chapter 65, if I'm not mistaken, Isaiah chapter 65, where the Bible teaches about how the holy angels, actually Isaiah chapter 6, and the Bible says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon the throne high and lifted up. And his train, the Bible says his train filled the temple. And above it stood the seraphims. And each one of them had six wings. With twain he covered his face. And with twain he covered his feet. And with twain he did fly. This is the seraphim and the cherubims. And watch this. And one cried to another. They sang antiphonally, if you will. They sang back and forth to one another. The Bible says they said, they cried out unto one to another, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And that praise, the Bible says, the post of the doors moved at the voice of him that cried. And the house was filled with smoke. It was the angel's job to sing praises to God. And they did it 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They didn't get tired of singing like some of us who only sing once every other week, if that much. They say, holy, 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 because God is worthy. And if that's not good enough, go in Revelation chapter 4. Revelation chapter 4, around verse number 8, the Bible says this, and the four beasts had each of them six wings about them, and they were full of eyes within, and they rest, watch this, rest not day or night, saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. Is that in your Bible? Yeah. So understand this, brothers and sisters, we serve a God who is holy, holy, holy. Three times is the number of completion. It simply means he's completely holy. There's nothing beyond him. There's nothing beyond him, or below him, or above him, or to the right or the left. God is holy. And for that very reason, we ought to praise him like we know he's holy.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, that's not all. That's not all. I want you to understand that joy is the outward sign of the inward experience of grace. Gladness is not glibness. The distinguishing mark of anyone who is truly thankful for the goodness of the Lord should be joy. Christians ought to be the most joyful people on earth.
Amen.
Our lives should serve as a letter of commendation for knowing God. Our service should be rendered out of a heart filled with both reverence and joy. No one assisted God in creation. No one advised him. He did it alone.
Amen.
You recall in Job chapter 38, verse number 4, when he says, where was thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? Declare if thou hast understanding. Over there in Isaiah chapter 58, verse 8 and 9, the Bible says, for my thoughts, my thoughts are not your thoughts. Neither are my ways your ways. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts.
Amen.
So brothers and sisters, we have to understand that once we understand the presence of worship, and the present, and then in the preparation of worship, then we also have to understand, lastly, the power of worship. Verse number 4 says this, enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him. And watch this, and bless his name.
Amen.
Now it says enter, that's a command. It says to bring, to go into his gates with thanksgiving. And so we ought to come to God. When we come into his presence, we ought to come to God with thanksgiving. You know, oftentimes we come to God with wants and and desires, but we don't rarely come to God with thanksgiving. We rarely open up our prayers and say, thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
You know, it reminds me of the story of the old woman in church. She would come to church every Sunday, and her prayer was, oh Lord, thank you, Jesus. Simple prayer. She would come to church the next Sunday, and she would say, oh Lord, thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
She repeated this prayer over and over again. So perfunctory was this prayer that the children began to laugh at her,
yes,
because they predicted what she was going to say. She'd come down in front and she'd say, oh Lord, thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Thank you.
And one day, the minister, after hearing her say this for weeks and weeks and months, and sometimes year for year,
yes,
he said, sister, what do you mean by that simple prayer that you pray every Sunday?
Amen.
Oh Lord, thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
She said, minister, I live in a bad neighborhood.
Yes, Lord.
She says, when I go to sleep at night, I hear gunfire. So I go in and I grab my grandkids and I lay prostrate on the floor.
Yes, Lord.
And so I say, oh Lord. But when I wake up in the morning and none of my grandkids are killed or shot, I say, thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
She says, when I take my little babies down to the bus stop, 6 o'clock in the morning, I say, oh Lord. But when I see him at 3:30,
yes,
and no harm has come to them,